Hey, Dara.
Sean, how are we?
All right. Friday Fight Talk. Episode one. We're just going to talk quickly about UFC and Fox this weekend.
Yeah.
The UFC are kind of, they're leaving Fox. Bit of a divorce going on, so they're like occasionally putting a couple of good fights and then fights you're not really bothered about. Just to kind of get that over with until they move. They're moving to ESPN.
Anyway. Yeah.
I want to talk about just three fights here.
Yeah.
There are three really cool fights. I'm sorry to anyone else who happens to be listening to this. Highly unlikely.
Yeah, very unlikely. But
who's on the rest of the card? But the...
I know the three fights you're on about anyway. I think most people who are listening were going to know what fights we're on about.
They're pretty cool fights. This is like a dry run for next week for the pay-per-view because there's some amazing fights on that too. But let's go with Joanna Jędrzejczyk, Tisha Torres. How do you think this is going to go? Because Joanna's on the comeback from her two losses to Rose.
Yeah, it just depends how she recovers from it. Obviously, two losses to Rose Namajunas, if that's how you pronounce it. I'm like the Paul Merson.
Namajunas.
I'm like the Paul Merson of pronouncing fighters' names. I'm not even going to pronounce Joanna's last name.
Joanna Jędrzejczyk.
Yeah, let's just go on anyway.
It's not that hard.
I know. Well, I'll rehearse it for next time. I haven't had much time. But yeah, I think that Joanna should win this. She's obviously, those two fights were her most. Two losses in a row. She needs to bounce back from it. And we'll see how it goes. But
well, we saw in every fight up until the Rose fight that she was better than everyone else.
In the whole division.
By a significant margin. She's just... like, she's not got a lot of power.
Yeah.
But the way she fights with the front kicks, and head kicks, and the constant jab, jab, right, 1-2, 1-2. The constant pressure and constant... constantly throwing those combinations. She was just so much more skillful.
Yeah.
She
was league ahead of most of the people in that division. And then
the funny thing about Rose was almost built to beat her.
Yeah.
And that's kind of the whip, you know. It's kind of interesting. It'll be interesting to see how long Rose can hold the title when she's not fighting Joanna, because it seems like she was just built to beat her.
Yeah.
You know, like people talk a lot about Holly Holm. Holly Holm was never impressive in the fights leading up. She won all of her fights leading up to the Ronda fight, but they basically spent 3 or 4 years preparing her, built her to beat Ronda, and she did.
Ronda wanted the fight as well. She said it after Joe Rogan, and then she probably wished she never wished it then, because she just went down after that.
Well, let's not talk about that. That's not important.
Let's talk about the two fighters. Let's
talk about fights that are actually happening.
Yeah, not WWE fighters. That's for me and Will's podcast.
Yeah.
Just had to get that plug in there.
I can delete it later.
Yeah. Anyway, who are you saying? Joanna as well?
I think so. I think Joanna's beaten. They've beaten everyone.
Yeah.
And Tisha Torres said she's training with Rose to get a kind of a... learn some things from her. Joanna seems to be susceptible to Rose's left hook.
Yeah.
She got caught with that a load. Obviously, that was what knocked her out the first time, but then she got caught a load in the second fight too, and it was...
I just
think if you're looking at it, forgetting the Rose fight, and you just to say this, you would always back Joanna.
Yeah.
But she's had two losses. How is her confidence? Or is this exactly what she needed to sort of get back to where she was?
Yeah.
You know, and or is
yeah, it? I can see her getting back up to that level, get within a chance of getting the third fight against Rose, if she's still champion at the time. There's still a few movements with the women's divisions, so we'll see. There could be a few super fights on the card.
Is there any talk about who Rose is going to fight next?
Doesn't seem to be.
Because it would seem that anyone that she could fight has already lost to Joanna.
So. Yeah, that's the thing. But that's the best thing about having a new champion. They face new people. They face everyone that the old champion has fought. It's different styles, different
Styles make fights.
Styles do make fights, and it'll be interesting to see.
So there's, the odds are massively in Joanna's favor, and we're probably saying that would seem the most likely outcome.
Yeah,
we'll go with that. We'll stick with that. Next fight I want to get talked to is my favorite fight of the night.
Yeah,
Jose Aldo, Jeremy Stephens. I love Jeremy Stephens.
Yeah, he's
he throws bricks, and he's not one bit ashamed of it. No. He actually came out and said that he can't wait to go leg kick for leg kick with Aldo.
Yeah,
because you know he's fond of his leg kicks too. So, like I think he's improved. Before he was always looking for the knockout, and he could get out skilled. But he seems to have made a massive improvement since he had those couple of losses to Frankie Edgar and Max Holloway. And then he won a decision versus Gilbert instead of just going for the kill.
Yeah.
And then he's won two knockouts since then. And I think he's just picked it up a little bit again. Like he was sort of drifting away out of the top five.
A bit of a career renaissance.
But he's having a bit of a career renaissance. And you know, Aldo's been knocked out by straight rights from Max Holloway in his last two fights.
Three out of his last four fights have been lost by knockout, and if you consider before that, he was 10 years undefeated. 10 years, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's what happens. You know, he spars very hard. He's probably taken a lot of punishment in training too, and eventually once you've had that, you know, you've been cracked.
Yeah.
It can be hard to not have it happen again.
Yeah. If he doesn't win this fight, what do you think's next for him? Because he basically has beaten most of that division. Is he just going to be in featherweight purgatory, or do you think he'll move up? Or
I don't see why he shouldn't move up. But I think he could beat a lot of guys at 155.
Yeah, that's my thoughts.
His fight against Frankie Edgar,
UFC 200.
After we lost to McGregor, it was, you know, it was what you would call like a skillful defensive performance. He outboxed Frankie, and he didn't even bother using his leg kicks, and he just defended any wrestling Frankie tried to do, and he just boxed him around for a couple of rounds.
Yeah.
It looked so easy for him.
Mm.
Now the thing about this is, Jeremy Stephens is a good wrestler, but he won't come in to box and throw combinations and use, like do anything clever like Frankie might try and do on the feet. Jeremy Stephens is going to come in there to take Aldo's head off.
Mm-hmm.
And if he connects, he could, because like if McGregor knocked him out, Stephens is probably hits even harder.
Yeah.
If not like equally like, and it's a different kind of power. Like McGregor has that kind of floating, unbelievable accuracy where he can catch people out of nowhere, you know, and it's like it shocks people.
Yeah.
But Jeremy Stephens just comes in and he is winging shots at you.
Just two bricks for hands.
He wants to hurt people.
Mm.
So, I can't wait for that fight. I'm gonna predict Jeremy Stephens is gonna win.
Yeah, to be honest, I wouldn't be surprised if Stephens won. I'm trying to think. I do think Aldo, since the past few fights, he hasn't been the same. But I could see him maybe taking it on a decision or something like that. I either see an Aldo decision or a Stephens knockout. That's the only way I can see it. I don't know.
What was interesting about the two fights he had with Max Holloway is he started both of them well.
Yeah.
But after a while, Max was kind of telling him, you've done whatever
you've done your best.
Whatever damage you've done now I'm going to show you why I'm the best.
Yeah.
And Max would sort of let him come on. He would suck him into that fight.
Yeah.
And Max took a lot of punishment in those early rounds. He got clipped a few times. But he just kept coming back. And he just broke Aldo.
Mm-hmm.
Like the punishment he dished out on the ground in that first one when he knocked out Aldo, I think the ref could have stopped that ages ago. And I get that Aldo was defended, but man, once he had him down there, he was not letting him back up.
No chance at all.
And the second fight was completely different. Like again, Aldo started quickly, started well, showing his stuff. But again, once Max got his timing right and Aldo kind of slowed down, because Aldo, what he always did was he would dominate the first two rounds and coast the last three rounds.
Yeah.
And so he kind of like, he was trying to use that pace and power he has, and he would, explosiveness, and he would kind of dominate. But then when he slows down that fraction and Max gets his time in and he can unload volumes of punches, and he just land those straight rights, and he just, Max is so good though.
He's great. He's incredible. Yeah.
I hope he gets healthy. He's really sick at the minute.
Yeah.
It's a shame.
Yeah. I was looking forward to seeing that Brian Ortega and Holloway fight for the last one for the featherweight champion for the last pay per view, but yeah, unfortunately couldn't because of medical reasons. Even that interview he had with Bisping had to ask him, "Max, are you all right? You don't seem yourself." But hopefully he can recover, because there's a few nice matchups in the top of the featherweight division.
And if he goes to 155.
Yeah, 155 is probably the most one of the most stacked divisions anyway. So there's so many fights.
Both Brian Ortega and Max Holloway both plan to go to 155 soon anyway.
145 is for they're kind of lanky kind of characters. 145 is very, very hard to achieve. Even seen when McGregor was trying to do it. McGregor's a bit more...
Well, McGregor's about the same. He's 5'9 or whatever. Holloway is a kind of a narrower person than
more
McGregor.
More lankier, kind of, yeah.
But he's like 5'11.
Yeah, he's huge. Like,
he's very tall for the weight class. And even when you look at Brian Ortega when he's not fighting, he looks he looks much bigger than a 145er. But hey, be interesting to see what they two do. Jeremy Stephens, because he was preparing for this fight, had the opportunity of an interim title with Brian Ortega when Max pulled out of their fight a few weeks back. But Ortega said no, because he's not interested in an interim title, and he's only interested in beating Max.
Yeah.
And that's why people like, say, Khabib will maybe not always considered the best, even though Khabib's amazing. They kind of go, well, we know who the champion was. The champion was Eddie Alvarez, and we saw him get absolutely schooled by McGregor.
Yeah.
You know, and Khabib won his belt, taking on Ali Aquinta on one day's notice.
Oh, jeez, there were so many changes to the match. It went from Khabib to Tony Ferguson. It went then to Max Holloway was meant to come up, but he couldn't get to the right thing.
Let's not talk about it. I think it's such a mess.
Yeah, Ali Aquinta's just, no.
Well, Ali Aquinta's class.
But it's what, just he's not day, at that level
he
yet.
One day's notice.
Yeah. Oh, that was a mess. That mess.
Anyway, but like, supposedly that was a title fight. But, you know, so but it's going to be hard. But, you know, they'll probably sort that out eventually. Let's get back to talk about Jeremy Stephens. Stephens on three fight wins. Aldo is coming off his two losses to Max. Like, he's not even old, he's maybe 30 at the most, Aldo, but he's just been around so long. He's taken a lot of punishment. I wonder, is he getting that stage where he just can't take the punishment anymore? Or maybe he needs to go up to 155 so that he's not sucking it down, he can put on a bit more weight, maybe he can sustain a bit more damage, but he's taken so much damage in these last four fights.
Yeah,
I mean, huge. He didn't take a lot in the Frankie Edgar fight, but he took 3 punches from McGregor in their fight, and they were fucking unreal.
Yeah. I'll never forget that night.
You know, and then in the Max Holloway fights, they're potentially worse, because what McGregor did was McGregor was like, "You're out."
Yeah.
Whereas Max beat on him and beat on him.
Embarrassed him.
Once he got on top in the fight, he beat on him and beat him until he basically broke him. And,
mm-hmm.
and he did it twice, and it's...
Yeah,
it's a. I just wonder how will it be that he's so skillful that he'll be able to just be too classy for Jeremy Stephens, but I'm just thinking I think Stephens.
You always see Aldo against you know the kind of the number 3, number 4 contenders in the division, and they were usually like, you know, they were easy fights for him, but you know McGregor, Holloway, they're special characters. Ortega could end up being a special one. That would be a good fight. But Jeremy Stephens, as we said, he's having a bit of a career renaissance. He could do the business. It only takes one punch.
And he throws bricks.
Yeah, major bricks.
If he can survive Aldo's early onslaught and start landing some of his own stuff, he could really do some damage. So I'm going to go with Jeremy Stephens. And we'll see what happens.
I'm going to say Aldo decision.
You're going to say Aldo decision?
I'll just try and be a bit...
Well,
a bit different.
From what I've seen, the odds, it's very close. I think Aldo's a slight favourite. Because, obviously, of his history. Main event's interesting too.
Mm-hmm.
We've got Eddie Alvarez, Dustin Poirier in their rematch after their first fight. Was the first fight a disqualification or a no contest?
It was given as a no contest, I do believe.
Does it even matter? We know what happened is that Poirier showed how good of a boxer he is. He's a very good fighter. He's got a great all-around skill set. And I've heard people refer to him as a gatekeeper before, because it's like, if you want to get in the top five, like it was the same when he was a featherweight, it's the same one. If you want to get in the top five, you need to be good enough to beat Dustin Poirier. And if you're not, he beat Justin Gaethje, didn't he?
Yeah. Both men have beaten Justin Gaethje.
Yeah, like Justin Gaethje came over and he was like, well, I'm going to beat everyone. I'm a world champion, a World Series of Fighting. And
welcome to the UFC.
You know, Dustin Poirier's like, no, like he doesn't like being known as this, but he's like the gatekeeper to the top five in those divisions. Like, if you can get past him, you could probably fight for the title.
Yeah.
But he is such a good fighter. Like, he beat Joe Duffy. Like, Joe Duffy, everyone thought he was going to come straight in at 155 and go right through. But he beat Joe Duffy, and he beat him well. Although he did actually get his nose broken in that fight.
Yeah, but he still won it.
It was a great fight. You know, both guys put a lot into it, but he was just that bit better. And then you had, we'll go back to this fight with Alvarez. This was a good fight. Both guys looking to just beat each other up. Poirier got on top. Then Alvarez landed one of his big shots.
Yeah.
He gets a bit on top. He goes to throw some knees because his face is covered in blood and all he sees in front of him is a head.
Yeah.
And he puts his hands in his head and he throws a knee, not realizing that he's his hands on the ground. It's initially a knockout, but then they overturn it because his hands on the ground and really nobody has a clue what's going on. Once they stop the fight to check the replay, the fight's over. I don't know why they bother checking the replay. They should just stop the fight. If you're going to stop the fight to check replays, like, they can't keep
checking. It's like VAR again.
Like, if you bring the doctor in, the doctor's going to stop the fight. He's not going to go in there and go, it'll be fine. And then if something bad happens, the doctor's at fault. So the doctor's always going to stop the fight. So as soon as he walks in, I'm like, well, this fight's over.
Mm.
So what do you think is going to happen this time?
This time, it's the thing is about UFC, anyone can win, but
yeah, there's so many ways to win.
Yeah, I know that this is I between the two, they're so number three and four. I think they are at the minute in the featherweight division. Sorry, not featherweight, lightweight division. That lightweight division is stacked
just,
to be
just
up.
Just say 155, because giving it the boxing names is so weird because the weights are totally different.
I know. I'm not good with numbers. I'm better with my words.
155 pounds.
155.
Even though both guys will probably weigh closer to 170 when they get in there.
Yeah, most definitely.
We'll not talk about weight cutting right now. That's not really something we're professionals
at. Yeah, we could be here for a few days talking about that. But yeah, any of these lads could win. Poirier, I think, since coming up, Poirier, whatever way you want to pronounce it, since coming up to 155, he's been pretty good. He has got some great wins under his belt.
Way too big for 155.
Oh yeah, massive. But he's had some good wins on the way up to the top, and he's had some wars. Yeah, both of them are just two brawlers. You've seen the last fight.
Anyone listening to this wants to know about Eddie Alvarez needs to look for a video by Robin Black.
Mm.
Robin Black, best MMA analyst there is. Look for a video. He's actually two videos on it. It's called the Sap Alvarez Scale. It's named after Bob Sapp and Eddie Alvarez. The two opposite ends of the spectrum is the way around. Like, I don't want to go into too much. The Sap Alvarez Scale is a brilliant way to he describes Eddie Alvarez perfectly in that.
Mm.
He is the ultimate game day player. He's a dog. He was called the Underground King for a long time. But he's a guy who can wrestle. He's a guy who can submit people. He's a guy who can knock people out. He is a real, real animal.
Yeah.
But, so, it's hard to know, though, because like, Poirier is really good. He's really good at everything, and he's probably got a reach advantage over Alvarez, and he's usually able to stop wrestling, you know. So, what do you think this is going to go?
I'm going to say Poirier for this one. It might not turn like that, but I'm just going to say Poirier. Alvarez, great fighter, nothing against him. I just think Poirier, just as you say, he probably is the reach. Anything can happen in this fight, it's so down the middle. I don't see one clear cut winner in this.
Eddie Alvarez is such a good guy. I'm going to go with Alvarez in this one.
Yeah.
It's five rounds. You're going with decision. You're going with knockout. Either one could knock each other out.
Yeah, for some reason I can't see this fight going the full Monty. I'll just say...
I'm going to say Alvarez TKO.
Okay, I'll say Poirier knockout in the... I'll say TKO as well in second round.
I will also say second round. But for Alvarez...
Let's hope it gets the second round anyway.
Well, you know what? This if it ends up being a 5-round, well, it shows what you know.
Yes.
We've both gone with Joanna.
Yeah.
You're going with Aldo, I'm going with Stevenson. That's probably me just really liking Stevenson.
Yeah.
And then the same thing, I'm going with Alvarez, but you're going with Poirier.
Yeah. Not to be different, it's just how I feel. Yeah, not trying to argue.
Look, man, it's gonna be some great fights. You know.
Yeah.
Sorry to anyone in the rest of the card that I'm sure there are loads of you listening to this.
Yeah.
But
listening from Vegas, I don't think so.
We had a limited time here on our in PQ Pods HQ today to throw this together, and that's where we're going for this. We just focus on these three main fights.
Yeah.
All right, Dara. It's all over already. Peace out. Good luck.